Good morning.
Good morning.
I welcome you all as we gather on this 20th Sunday of Pentecost. Extend a warm greeting to those who are worshiping with us for the first time, both here in the sanctuary and online. I thank Kyle Hastings for serving as our tech person this morning. The altar flowers are given in memory of Jean Davern's parents, Tom and Rachel Flynn, also her brother John and sister Judy. The altar flowers are also given in memory of Roy and Callie Fitzgerald by their children. During the prayers of the faithful, if you have something weighing upon your heart, something that you would like to lift up to the Lord in celebration as well, just raise your hand and I will come to you. Those who are worshiping with us online, you can type your prayer requests into the chat box. As we celebrate communion, we will pass the peace, but instead of shaking people's hands, I invite you to just cross your arms in front of you and ask God's blessing to be upon each other. And I encourage you to share the peace of Christ with someone you do not know. I believe Gail, our Minister of Discipleship, has at least one announcement.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have a few, so bear with me. The children are continuing their Reader's Theater, so please continue to join us for that on Sundays. Save the date for October 31st. We are having our Trunk or Treat, and it will be bigger this year, inviting the whole community. There's a sign-up sheet for different ways you can help on the bulletin board. It will also be in the Hilltop News. Thank you.
And this is a way in which we are trying to reach out to our community and let them see what a wonderful community of faith we have here. And Patrick has an announcement.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So we have another young adult meetup today, and this one is going to the Topsfield Fair, and we're meeting at the church at 4 o'clock. And so if you haven't heard about the young adult meetup before, Daniela and I are essentially, we've put together a group for 20 and 30 somethings kind of in the North Reading area, people who are affiliated with the church, or even if they're interested in bringing friends as well. Last week we went to Smolak Farms. It was actually a really beautiful day. It was very fun, entertaining, and we didn't have to mug any kids to get our apples. We picked a whole bushel of apples, and it's a good time. So if it sounds like something that you're interested in today, once again, 4 o'clock, we're meeting at the church, and we're going over to the Topsfield Fair. So thank you.
Few more announcements. As we all know, the parking lot is almost finished. One of the finishing touches will be some landscaping, and we're going to be doing some fundraising for that so that people can donate in memory of loved ones or in honor of loved ones. And we do have a picture here of what the plan is right now. Not 100% etched in stone yet, but that will give you an idea. There'll be more information in the Hilltop News as well this coming week. Tuesday evening Bible study continues, and we are looking at going back to in-person, and that will probably be on Wednesday mornings, and so I invite you to stay tuned for that. The youth group will not meet this coming Friday because of the Columbus Day weekend. The bell choir and the chancel choir are back rehearsing. Chancel choir will be singing this morning, and the bell choir will be playing in 2 weeks, I believe, from today. So they rehearse on Tuesday evenings at 7 o'clock, and the choir rehearses here in the sanctuary on Sunday morning at 8:45. Also, there will be an inquirers gathering, and that is for people who are interested in joining our Fellowship of Faith. And there are a couple of dates and times that are being looked at for that, either Saturday or Sunday, October 16th or 17th, and the times are in the Hilltop News. If you would let me know what works for you, that would be much appreciated. Are there any other announcements? If not, then let us draw near to God's throne of grace as we rejoice in the love that is from everlasting to everlasting.
Please join me in the call to worship. On this day, Christians around the world gather as one.
Men and women come from the east and the west.
Children and youth come from the north and the south.
To know the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread.
To know the risen Christ in the sharing of the cup.
To proclaim that we are one.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Holy One, on this worldwide Communion Sunday, we remember that it was our Savior's deepest desire that we all be one. Sadly, in these days that are full of arguing and animosity, we confess that we are far from the love that is not jealous or boastful, the love that is not arrogant or rude, the love that is not irritable or resentful. Forgive us, Lord, for those moments when being right is more important than loving one another as our Savior loves us. Holy One, create in us a clean heart and lead us once again
to your paths of righteousness. For we ask it as disciples of your only begotten Son. Amen.
Good people, please join me in the assurance of pardon. People of God, hear the good news. If anyone is in Christ, that person is a new creation.
The old has passed away, and the new has come.
Let us rejoice and be glad, for in Jesus Christ there is forgiveness of sins and fullness of life. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto him. Amen. I invite you to pass the peace of Christ with one another. Peace be with you, Pam.
Thank you.
And you too.
Peace be with you, Jay. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Harry. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Brian, Betty. God bless. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Mary.
It's so good to see you. How are you?
God bless you. Bless how I do. So wonderful. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Jolie. Peace be with you, Mary. Laura. Peace be with you. Welcome back.
Thank you.
You were in England.
I have been.
Good
yes.
for you. God bless. God bless you. Please be seated. We come this day to celebrate the goodness of our God with our songs and our words of praise. We also come to celebrate our blessings with our deeds of loving kindness and by dedicating ourselves to be a people who reaches out to share the love of Christ in the wider world. So let us accept that calling as we come now to God's altar with our tithes and our offerings.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication.
God whose glory fills the
heavens and whose grace has touched my heart, I come to your altar this day to praise you for all of my blessings. Along with my humble gratitude, I also bring you this offering and pray that it will give birth to a few more deeds of loving kindness. This I pray in the name of the risen Christ, who has called us to follow him. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. Please join me in the responsive call to prayer. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you.
Let us lift up our hearts to the Lord.
Good people, let us give thanks as we enter into this time of sacred silence. My sisters and brothers, are there prayers that you would like to lift up to the Lord this morning? Yes, Jeannie.
For my sister, Kathy Marr, who will be having knee replacement surgery on Wednesday.
So we lift up in prayer Jeannie Davern's sister, Kathy Marr, as she has knee replacement surgery. Lord, in your goodness,
hear our prayer.
I lift up in prayer Hugh McLucas, who is on hospice, and he is a friend of the Malik family. We ask that God be with all of them as they walk this path together. Lord, in your goodness,
hear our prayer.
Also received word last night that Larry and Sarah Lynn Spire's son Andrew is in a hospital up in Maine with COVID, and he is on oxygen. So we lift up him in prayer, ask God's spirit of healing to be upon him. Larry and Sarah Lynn were longtime members here at Union Congregational Church before they moved to Maine a number of years ago. And again, we ask that God's healing be upon their son, Andrew. Lord, in your goodness, we do give thanks for healing that has come to Nate Sherrill, Jack and Jane Hudgens' son-in-law. He is recovering from COVID, and for that we give thanks. Lord, in your goodness,
hear our prayer.
We also lift up in prayer Sandy Hayes. It's his son, Billy Hayes, as he continues to be treated with a rare form of cancer. As many of you know, he had surgery about a month ago. Things were looking good, and then they discovered that it was a much more aggressive form of cancer. And so we lift him up in prayer, as well as Sandy and her entire family. Lord, in your goodness, let us pray. Eternal God, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end of all things, and you are here with us in this in-between time right now. And for that, we give you thanks. As we continue our journey through life, individually and together, we know that you are waiting for us in tomorrow, and all the days that are yet to be, and for that we give you thanks. Holy One, as we walk the path of life, we pray that our hearts and our minds and our hands might be open, that we might embrace one another with goodness and kindness and the peace that passes all understanding. Lord God, in a world that is convulsing at times with so much hatred and suffering, we pray that you will help us to be the voice and the hands of Christ. Lord God, you have given each of us gifts in different measure. Help us to look within and see those gifts and others that we might not even realize are there. All this we ask that we may be a community of faith that does your will here on earth as it is in heaven. And all this we pray through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Before I read, if there are any children that are still here, you may leave for Sunday school. Today's reading comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 13, 31 through 35. At that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to Jesus, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you." And he said to them, "Go and tell that fox, 'Behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I finish my course. Nevertheless, I must go on my way today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish away from Jerusalem. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it, how often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you would not. Behold, your house is forsaken, and I tell you, you will not see me until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Here ends the reading of the word.
Pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts upon the sacred word be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and always our Redeemer. Amen. Blondie. Her name was Blondie. Now, don't ask me why I remember this, but Blondie... So Blondie was Adolf Hitler's dog. And by all accounts, he loved his dog.
Is it on? There we go. So, Hitler loved his dog, which just goes to show you that your mother was right. If you try hard enough, you can find some good in everyone. Hitler loved his dog, and he was evil. But maybe he was only 99.999% evil. Sometimes it's hard. But if you try hard enough, you can find some good in everyone. That's what a minister had to do one day when a mother asked him to do a funeral for her son. Unfortunately, the son was a snake and a sneak and an unrepentant sinner, and everyone knew it. Which is why the mother told the minister that she was going to donate $10,000 to the church if he did her son's funeral. But there's a condition, the mother said. You have to tell everyone that my boy was a saint. Well, the church really needed the money. So the minister agreed to do the funeral with the mother's condition. On the day of the funeral, when the time came for the eulogy, the minister stood up and he looked at the mother. Then he looked at everyone else in the church, and after taking a deep breath, he said, "Sisters and brothers, the man that you see before you was a drunk and a cheat, a womanizer and a thief, but I will say this, compared to his brothers, he was a saint." Yes, if you try hard enough, you can find some good in everyone. Just look at the Pharisees. I know, you're going to remind me that the Pharisees were the bad guys who were always trying to get Jesus into trouble. And you're right. You can see that from one end of the Gospels to the other. In fact, here are a few examples. Mark chapter 8, verse 11. The Pharisees came and began to argue with Jesus. Luke 6, verse 7. The Pharisees watched Jesus so that they might find a reason to accuse him. And here's the best one of all. Matthew 12, verse 14. The Pharisees went out and conspired against Jesus so that they might destroy him. Yes, there's no doubt about it. The Pharisees were the bad guys who were always trying to get Jesus into trouble. But here's a question for you. If that's true, then how do you explain the reading this morning from Luke's gospel? Luke tells us that while Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, some Pharisees came to him and said, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you." How about that? On this particular occasion, the Pharisees were the good guys. They went out of their way to help Jesus and save his life. So they weren't all bad. All of this reminds me of a story about a Sunday school teacher who read a parable to the children and then asked them a question. Children, she said, if all the good people in the world were white sheep and all the bad people in the world were black sheep, what color would you be? Immediately, a little girl raised her hand and said, I'd be striped. What a wonderful, wise, and honest answer. Most things in life aren't black and white. Just look at the Pharisees. Here's another example. Once upon a time, we were told that we are all male or female. But now we're being told that not everyone fits neatly into those two categories. Some people are, quote, non-binary, unquote. Now, I will confess that I've struggled with this at times. But I also remember reading an article about some fascinating children a number of years ago, and it opened my mind a little. Did you know that there is a village in the Dominican Republic where some of the girls become boys when they reach their teenage years? It's true. You can Google it. In the village of Salinas, some of the girls physically change and become boys as they get older. Here's something else that opened my mind a little when it comes to this new reality. Do you remember what happened when God created Adam in the Garden of Eden? We're told that the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God took from the man, he made into woman and brought her to the man, and she was called Eve. Do you know what that means? It means right from the very beginning, Adam had some of Eve's DNA in him. And after Eve was created, she had some of Adam's DNA in her. So there was a little male and female in each of them. And if we're descended from Adam and Eve, is that also true for us? Good people, it's struggling at times, but not everything in life is black and white. Just look at Adam and Eve. Just look at the Pharisees who went out of their way to help Jesus and save his life. Just look at Henry Ward Beecher. Any of you remember Henry Ward Beecher? He was a Congregational minister in the days leading up to the Civil War. And he wasn't bashful when it came to condemning slavery as sinful and evil. Not everyone shared his views, though, which is why Reverend Beecher wasn't entirely surprised when he got up to preach one Sunday morning and he found a note in the pulpit that had a single word written on it. That word was fool, F-O-O-L, exclamation point. According to the story, Reverend Beecher showed the congregation the note and then said, I have known of many an instance where a person wrote a letter and forgot to sign their name. But this is the only instance I can remember where the person signed their name and forgot to write the letter. Now, you could say that there was a little bit of a sinner in the person who left that note in the pulpit. But you can also say that there was a little bit of a sinner in Reverend Beecher. After all, do you remember what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount? He said, if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to them the other also. Or, as my mother always said, two wrongs don't make a right. Put it all together and it's simple. God didn't create a world where everything is black and white. God created a technicolor world full of people who are different and things that we don't fully understand. And I will be the first to admit that it can be difficult living in this technicolor world. It can be messy and muddy and murky. But make no mistake about it, God's grace is waiting for you in that technicolor world. God's blessings are waiting for you in that technicolor world. God's love is waiting for you in the world that is technicolor. Many years ago, Samuel Colgate, the man who founded the Colgate business empire, found himself dealing with a situation that wasn't black and white. It happened in the church that he attended in North Orange, New Jersey. During the service one morning, the minister invited all those who wished to give their life to Christ to come forward. To the surprise of many people, the first person who answered that invitation and came forward was a woman who was a well-known prostitute. As she knelt at the altar, weeping, there was an awkward silence in the sanctuary. That silence was broken when Samuel Colgate stood up and said to everyone there, "I guess we blundered when we prayed that the Lord would save sinners. We forgot to specify what kind of sinners. We'd better ask the Lord to forgive us for this oversight. The Holy Spirit has touched this woman and made her truly repentant. But the Lord apparently doesn't understand that she's not the kind of sinner we want to rescue. We'd better spell it out for him, just which sinners we had in mind." Those words made everybody realize that there's a little saint and a little sinner in all of us. And the good news is that the congregation then joyfully welcomed the woman into the community of faith with open arms. Isn't that a wonderful story? Wonderful things happen when you have the faith and the courage to live in God's technicolor world. Amen.
Thank you. seated. Let us pray. Eternal God, you have created the heavens and the earth, giving life to every living thing. So we thank you for all the gifts of creation and for the gift of life itself. We are humbled that you have made us in your own divine image, and that you continue to reach out to us in love when we act as though you have no claim upon us. As we gather around this table, we rejoice in Jesus Christ, the only one eternally begotten of you, who was born of your servant Mary, and shared the joys and sorrows of life as we know it. Together we celebrate Christ's resurrection, and we await his return at the end of time. Until then, we ask you to send your Spirit upon this bread and this cup. Bless all of us in our eating and drinking at the table, that our eyes may be opened and we may recognize the risen Christ in our midst, in each other, and in all for whom Christ died. Amen. On that night long ago, Jesus took the bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, all of you, for this is my body broken for you." Ministering to you in his name, we give you this bread. Let us eat of the bread, and may the spirit of love that was in him be in us also.
In like manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it. He gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, drink, all of you. For this is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Ministering to you in his name, we give you this cup. Let us drink of the cup and rejoice in the promise of everlasting life. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have called us to your table and granted us the presence of the living Christ. As you have strengthened our faith and our love for one another, send us forth now into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. For we ask it in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh,
People of God, our service of worship is ended. Let us go forth to continue our service of love no matter where we are. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Creator Christ and Holy Spirit, be upon you all. Amen.